Good morning.
Hedda? Good heavens, are you up so early?
Don't speak so loud.
Mrs. Elvsted is resting in my room.
Has Miss Elvsted been here all night?
Yes. Since no one came to fetch her. Well, did you enjoy yourselves at Judge Brack's?
Have you been anxious about me, Hedda?
No. I should never think of being anxious. But I asked if you had enjoyed yourself.
Oh, yes. For once in a way, especially the beginning of the evening. For Eyelet read me part of his book. We arrived more than an hour too early and Brack had all sorts of arrangements to do, so Eyelet read to me.
Well? Tell me then.
Oh, Hedda. You can't conceive what a book that is going to be. I believe it is one of the most remarkable things that has ever been written.
Yes, yes, I don't care about that.
I must make a confession to you, Hedda. When he read to me, a horrid feeling came over me. I felt jealous of Eyelet for having had it in him to write such a book. Only think, Hedda.
Yes, yes, I am thinking.
And how pitiful to think that he, with all his gifts, should be irreclaimable after all.
I suppose you mean he has more courage than the rest.
No, I mean that he's incapable of taking his pleasure in moderation.
And what came of it all, in the end?
Well, to tell you the truth, I think it's best described as an orgy, Hedda.
Had he vine leaves in his hair?
Vine leaves? No, nothing of the sort. But he made a long rambling speech in honour of the woman that had inspired him in his work. That was the phrase he used.
Did he name her?
No. But I can't help think he meant Miss Elvsted. You won't be sure he did.
Then where did you part from him?
On the way to town. We broke up, the last of us at any rate, altogether, and Brack came with us to get a breath of fresh air. And we agreed to take Eyelet home, for he had far more than what was good for him. But now comes the strange part of it, Hedda, or I should rather say the melancholy part of it. I declare I'm always ashamed in Eyelet's account to tell you.
Oh, go on.
Well, as I was getting near town, you see, I happened to drop a little behind the others, only for a minute or two.
Yes, yes, bud.
And what do you think I found by the wayside, huh?
How should I know?
You mustn't speak of it to a soul, Hedda, do you hear? Promise me, for Eyelet's sake. Hedda, dear. I found this.
Is not that the parcel he had with him yesterday?
Yes. It is his precious, irreclaimable manuscript, and he had gone and lost it and knew nothing about it. Oh, Hedda, so deplorably.
But why did you not give him back the parcel at once?
I didn't dare to in the state he was then in.
Did you not tell any of the others that you had found it?
Oh, far from it. You can surely understand, for Eyelet's sake, I wouldn't do that.
So no one knows that Eyelet Loveborg's manuscript is in your possession?
No. And no one must know it.
Then what did you say to him afterwards?
I didn't talk to him again. For when we broke off amongst the streets, he and two or three of the others gave us a slip and disappeared.
Indeed. They must have taken him home then.
So it appeared. Oh, and Brack too left us.
And what have you been doing with yourself since?
Well, I and some of the others went home with one of the party, a jolly fellow, and took our morning coffee with him. Or I should rather say, our night coffee, huh? But now, when I have rested a little and given poor fellow Eyelet time to have his sleep out, I must take this back to him.
Oh, no.
Don't give it to him. Not in such a hurry, I mean. Let me read it first.
No. My dearest Hedda, I mustn't. I really mustn't.
You must not?
No. For you can imagine what a state of despair he will be in when he wakes and misses the manuscript. He has no copy, you must know. He told me so.
Can such a thing not be reproduced? Written over again?
No, I don't think that is possible for the inspiration, you see.
Yes, yes, I suppose it depends on that. But, by the by, here's a letter for you. It came early this morning.
Oh, it's from Aunt Julia. Oh, Hedda, it says that poor Aunt Rena is dying.
Well, we were prepared for that.
I must make haste.
Will you run?
Oh, my dearest Hedda, if you could only make up your mind and come with me, just think, huh?
No, no, don't ask me. I will not look upon sickness and death. I loathe all kinds of ugliness.